When the greatest event unfolded in human memory, when the prehistoric aurora of the perceived gods seemed angered, the ancient American population exploded with cultural rituals and worship of the event that they thought could be controlled with worship and sacrifice. Structures arise above the tree canopy, their stairway to the apparent abode of the gods. They wondered what it was, and they tried to reach the cosmic place of the squatter man who would kill, torment, and destroy humans in their habitat. The destruction came after a period of prosperity as the plasma manifested through the discrete phases, and this overwhelmingly influenced the desperation felt by the ancients. The apparent god they thought could be appeased with further sacrifice, worship, and dedication. But this was the event of cosmic disorder that would see Earthlings everywhere scramble for answers, as utter desperation took hold onto the society they had known for generations. This was the manifestation of a preconception that would blind us for centuries to come. The worldwide cataclysm of the prehistoric aurora. Wait till you hear this. Mesoamerican cultural belief tells us that at the beginning of time, the first god created himself and eventually gave birth to four other children, who then presided over the four cardinal points. This was the manifestation in the sky and immortalized in the legend of the five sons, which tells us of a time of the one god, a time of prosperity before the four other gods manifested and destroyed the world before civilization emerged from the ashes they had created. The source of the ancient Golden Age was also where a manifestation of destruction emerged. It can be hypothesized that a planet like Saturn could shine as a failing sun or something like that before going through an end cycle, similar to that of what the sun will go through as its fuel renders to an end. Electrically exchanging plasma with other planets, including the Earth, the intensity of the plasma hitting the Earth would seem like an attack from the once giver of light, and an effort to appease the event spawned religious belief everywhere. In Mesoamerica, a great squatterman-type deity emerges in the form of Tlatelolco, exactly representative of the form of the squatter man in the petroglyph record. During the age of the fifth sun, her eventually dismembered body would give rise to the civilization known to the world as the Aztecs. And from these facts, it can be assumed that the myths involving this deity are representative of the electrical activity taking place in the sky, influencing the cultures who witnessed it beyond recognition, as the trauma inflicted over the millennia-long event separated this time from the age of the golden epic. Tlatelolco to the Aztecs was a source of life, and because of this, they constantly wanted to appease her, mostly doing this by sacrifice of blood involving the human heart being torn from the body in an effort to ensure the continued stability and world order, as the previous cataclysm sparked by a great solar manifestation, which was perceived as gods, was still in memory when the planets were literally the gods, exchanging highly charged plasma, vaporizing Earthlings, the apparent anger of the gods. The idea of a creation myth involving a squatter deity goes back to the classic Mayan and the 5th century before Christ, a figure which is based on similar deities in the even earlier Olmec remembrance. In the creation mythology of the Aztecs, however, and other Mesoamerican cultures of the late post-classic period, the gods Quetzalcoatl and Tezcatlipoca, taking the form of gigantic snakes, descended from the heavens one day and found Tlatelolco sitting astride the ocean. Snakes descending to the earth are also depicted at Göbekli Tepe, events that seem impossible to us today were very common throughout the ancient world, and the entire planet saw it as one. The two gods, in the forms of snake-like manifestations, seemed to encounter the creator roaming the earth, and so they took it upon themselves to destroy her. A mighty tussle ensued in which Tezcatlipoca lost his left foot. They eventually rip Tlatecuhtli in two. From the upper half came the sky, and the other lower half became the earth. The shockwave evaporating into cosmic dust as balance returned to our world. The other gods were not best pleased to hear of Tlatecuhtli's treatment, and so decreed that the various parts of her dismembered body should give rise to features of the new world, and her skin became grasses, her freckles the flowers, her hair became the trees, sunflowers, and herbs, her eyes became springs and wells, her nose became the small mountains and valleys, her shoulders the large mountains, and her mouth became the caves and rivers. Despite being ripped to pieces and transformed into geographical features, the Mesoamericans still continue to think that Tlatecuhtli as an earth goddess, and they attribute any strange sounds coming from such features as either the screams of Tlatecuhtli in her dismembered agony or her calls for human blood to feed her. Indeed, the goddess gained a reputation for having an insatiable appetite for the hearts of sacrificial victims. This appetite had to be satisfied, or the goddess would cease her nourishment of the earth and crops would fail. This is how the ancients perceived the end of the electrical bombardment of the earth during the Saturnium supernova event. Their paranoia was so intense of their perceptions that they literally played out scenes as they thought they saw it in the heavens. The cultural rituals of sacrifice are appeasement events of a time they would do anything to not return to. Perhaps the key is in what they saw during the last struggles of Saturn as cosmic order evolved to what it is today. Another aspect of the goddess was that Tlatecuhtli was thought to swallow the sun every evening and regurgitate it the next morning at dawn. Echoing the Egyptian tradition and this solar connection ensured she was part of the prayer offered to Tezcatlipoca before an Aztec military campaign, for example. In various forms, she is an ancient Mesoamerican deity, but the earliest representations in sculpture are found at the Mayan city of Mayapan in Yucatan. This dates to the late post-classic period. More common in Aztec art, the goddess is often represented as a spread-eagled figure representing the hawker or squatter man, which is misjudged in the process of childbirth. The deity's mouth usually gapes with fangs or teeth or flint blades, showing tremendous plasma showering from her presence in every radial way possible. The most famous representation of this deity is on the colossal stone slab found near the base of the Templo Mayor of the Aztec capital Tenochtitlan, now central Mexico City. The pink andesite stone was broken into four pieces by the weight of a colonial building once above it. Put back together, it weighed around 12 tons. Carved in high relief on the stone is the familiar squatter figure of Tlatecuhtli, wearing a skull and bones dress, and with a river of blood flowing into her gaping mouth, representative of the prehistoric Aurora event. Another representation of the goddess is found on all four sides of the coronation stone of the Aztec ruler Montezuma II, and with her, the glyphs for water and fire, traditional symbols of war. The historian M. E. Miller is of the opinion that the face in the center of the celebrated Aztec sunstone is, in fact, Tlatecuhtli, and she there symbolizes the demise of the fifth and final sun of the Aztec cosmos, literally representing what they saw in the sky. The goddess was often carved onto the bottom of sculptures where the base touched the earth, and on the underside of the special stone boxes, which were used to keep the sacrificed hearts in which she was seemingly so partial to. Tlatecuhtli appears as a fanged monster in the form of a cornerstone of a pyramid platform at El Tajín, and this links the architectural belief of the stone as supporting the pyramid to her mythological function of supporting the earth. The worship of a sky deity and the effort to reach the heavenly abode to actually see what was going on before mayhem was unleashed and agriculture was lost. The deity signifies the end of the greatest event in living memory, a longing in the minds of the ancient earthlings of an event that is literally lost to history. But what do you guys think about this anyway? Comments below, and as always, thank you for watching.